Hello, no one is available to take your call. Please leave a message after the tone.
Hey, Georgie, Mr. Burger here. Just getting ready to start an episode. Let me know if you're interested. Thanks. Bye. Hey friends, welcome back to another episode of Art 101 with me, Mr. Burger. If you like this video, make sure you like, share, subscribe, so that you can be caught up on all of my content.
Talking about history.
For this video, we're changing things up pretty drastically. So, typically, in my Art 101 videos, what I'll do is I'll put up an artist like Vincent van Gogh. Sometimes it'll be a time period or a style of art, like Egyptians. Relevant. All right, so I got Egyptian art up. Bang, there's one. Bang, bang. A couple images. Talk about them. Here's what the art is. Here's why it's relevant. Walk through it. In this case, bang, we're looking at Cleopatra. Not an artist. Obviously not an art style. And we're going to just be focusing on subject matter for this video. And it's way, way different. And, you know, we'll see how it goes. I think that it should be interesting. So let's trudge ahead.
Gosh, mustache culture is pretty cool.
You betcha, son.
I guess I would say that Cleopatra is a bit of a historical anomaly. There are lots of things that we know about Cleopatra. There's a lot of things we don't know about Cleopatra. It's a lot of there's a lot of historical truth wrapped up in myth and legend, and that makes it very, very difficult sometimes to unwrap that box.
You sit on a throne of lies.
To tell the story of Cleopatra the VII, one should go all the way back to Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great died all the way back in 323, before our common era. And with an empire that stretched from Europe all the way to Asia, it had to be divided up after his death. Alexander's general Ptolemy would be placed in charge of the region of Egypt. His family would rule Egypt for 275 years and be the last dynasty of ancient Egypt. That tradition would end with Cleopatra the VII. Now here's the dyslexic's dream. At the age of 32, Alexander the Great had died. But at the age of 23, Cleopatra was marching into Rome as its ruler.
Oh, what does that old queen know?
Cleopatra would be born in the city founded by Alexander the Great, Alexandria. This is a city of palaces and temples, home to one of the seven ancient wonders of the world, the lighthouse. It also contained the Great Library, and without question, this was the greatest city in all of the world. From the get-go, Cleopatra won the lottery. She was in a place of high learning and culture. She was set up to be the next leader of Egypt by a father that trusted her abilities and potential. She had a Greek ancestry, but a knowledge of the Egyptian culture that would really serve her well moving forward, but we cannot forget that the powerhouse of the world was Rome. Any leader of this time would need to be flexible and intelligent, which Cleopatra certainly was, but she was also ruthless. And some have even gone as far as to say psychopathic.
I'm ready to go in, Coach. Just give me a chance. I know there's a lot riding on it, but it's all psychological.
I think one of the first things that you gotta unravel when you're dealing with Cleopatra is the idea of what is and what isn't beauty.
You're beautiful from head to toe to camel toe.
Thanks.
When the topic of beauty comes up, most of us instinctively are going to think about our time, our place, our world that we live in the context of what we know is beautiful, as opposed to what is true at the time and the place that the beauty was making itself realized. The time and the place that these artworks were created, the time and the place that these things are said.
Cleopatra very much had a reputation as a seductress. And this was even more reinforced by Hollywood starting all the way back in 1912. So for over 100 years, Hollywood has been reinforcing the fact that Cleopatra got as far as she did on her beauty, but this certainly is not the case.
Historians have always spoke of Cleopatra's great beauty, and the vernacular is a little bit off, and here's why. When we think of beauty, we're thinking of external beauty. But when the historians that wrote of this, when the Egyptians and the Romans that wrote of the story of Cleopatra, they're not speaking of her external beauty, they're speaking of her internal beauty. They're speaking of her her sharp mind, her great intellect, and how smart she is. That's what they're talking about when they're speaking of her beauty, her mind, not her outward appearance. Because by her outward appearance, she wasn't really as gorgeous of a person as what we historically have come to think.
Now that's a face that only a mama could love. What a beast.
Listen, fellas, another insult like that and I'm gonna make tuna salad out of you.
As I previously mentioned, Cleopatra's father had great faith in her. His name was Ptolemy the 12th, and because there are 12 Ptolemies, they all had little nicknames. He was pretty ruthless in his early years, so they called him the Bastard. But later his nickname would evolve into Orlides, or the Flute Player. This because he would skirt his responsibilities to play the flute.
Yeah, I heard enough of your tiddly-tick-tick-tick. You got it!
So Ptolemy the 14th brought his daughter in to help rule as deputy regent when she was only 14 years of age. Cleopatra and her father did work jointly in Rome in 58 BCE. They were on just such a trip. Basically, Ptolemy was in Rome to bribe Julius Caesar and Pompey to recognize him as the king of all of Egypt. Everything was taken care of, they're on their way back, but nearly simultaneously, Romans took control of the island of Cyprus. This country was under the control of Ptolemy's brother, who then committed suicide over his failures. Ptolemy didn't really want to bring a lot of attention to it. There were high levels of taxes going on, and this causes the Egyptian population to rise up in a huge rebellion.
Make up your mind quickly, or else.
So Ptolemy the 14th takes his daughter and leaves for Rome as a refugee. He basically puts his daughter Bernice the 4th in charge. But when her father was ready to retake the throne, she was having no part of giving it up. She would basically be forced out of power and be executed by beheading because of her insubordination to her father.
I'll kill you.
Not long after retaking the throne, Ptolemy would die. According to his will, he wished to pass the throne along to Cleopatra, but she needed to have someone to rule with. The co-ruler that was selected was her brother, which was very standard. A lot of monarchies throughout history in different places all around the world have wanted to preserve bloodlines by marrying within the family. So marrying first cousins, even brothers and sisters, was not completely historically unheard of. And 18-year-old Cleopatra would marry Ptolemy the 13th, her 10-year-old brother. Ptolemy the 13th and Cleopatra the 7th absolutely hated each other.
Soon as I get home, the first thing I'm gonna do is punch your mama in the mouth.
Now, stepping back just a moment, Ptolemy the 12th had some debts to Rome, and one of the members of the first triumvirate, Pompey, was instrumental in him being acknowledged as the ruler of Egypt. So after a civil war had broken out in Rome, Pompey had fled to Egypt as a refugee. And Julius Caesar was really looking to bring Pompey back to Rome so that he could have the consequences by his peers in Rome. So Julius Caesar makes the trip over to Egypt to try to round Pompey up to bring him back. And during this time, the leadership had transitioned to Cleopatra and Ptolemy the 13th. Each was trying to be the sole ruler and undercut the other. And Ptolemy the 13th got the upper hand, so he thought. It was known where Pompey was located, and he ordered some people to go out there and basically assassinate him. He would order for Pompey's head to be chopped off and preserved. While Julius Caesar was in Egypt, he would present Julius Caesar with the head of Pompey, thinking, yeah, he's really gonna think this is cool. But Julius Caesar was pissed. Because Rome was owed a bunch of money by Egypt, he could have easily just said, hey, you owe me money, fork out the cash now, or we're going to war. But he didn't do that. Cleopatra would have her own counter offer. Because she knew her brother's people were always watching Julius Caesar, she had to be very discreet and sneak in to have a meeting with Julius. So she has herself wrapped up in a rug and carried in to Julius Caesar. At this first meeting, Julius Caesar was very impressed by Cleopatra's intelligence, and they were able to work out a deal.
I told you if you were ever a shrimp boat captain, that I'd be your first mate. Well, here I am. I am a man of my word.
So Ptolemy the 13th still had a pretty strong military force in the cities and throughout the country, so it would take quite a force to remove him from power. So Julius Caesar and Cleopatra would unite their forces to go up against Ptolemy the 13th.
Thought I'd try out my sea legs.
This would peak with the Battle of the Nile in 47 BCE, where Julius Caesar and Cleopatra's forces very much overwhelmed Ptolemy the 13th. He tried to flee down the river, swimming down the river, where the 15-year-old would drown and die.
All those moments will be lost in time. Like tears in rain.
Cleopatra was very loyal to the idea of the independence in Egypt. She went so far to have relationships with others to be able to maintain that independence. With Cleopatra being the established ruler of Egypt, it would not take Julius Caesar long to make his way back to Rome. However, he would leave one more parting gift for Cleopatra. Cleopatra's first son, Caesarion, was fathered by Julius Caesar. Caesarion means Little Caesar.
Pizza, pizza!
It was a long-held expectation that females would have to have a co-ruler. With Ptolemy the 13th gone, and carrying Julius Caesar's son, she would still have to be married to maintain the throne of Egypt. So then she married Ptolemy the 14th, her little brother. So 25-year-old Cleopatra would marry 16-year-old Ptolemy the 14th, but she really had no interest in being married to him, so she would have him poisoned and killed. So the next person in line for the throne was her own son, Caesarion, whom she ruled with for the remainder of the Egyptian existence. Upon his return to Rome, Caesar would take the things that he learned in Egypt to reform the calendar, gain information by commissioning a census, building a great library, and making modern improvements to the infrastructure of the cities. And that would set him up to be assassinated. Two of the leaders in Rome, Octavian and Mark Antony, wanted Egypt's help after Caesar was killed.
None of which you understand, because you are a chicken.
Cleopatra would have been in Rome during this assassination, so the communication actually was pretty swift. After some dispute about the inheritance of Julius Caesar, like all things in time, it seemed to smooth itself out a little bit. The forming of the Second Triumvirate was created in Rome as a leadership mechanism. The three leaders that were involved in this were Octavian, Mark Antony, and Marcus Aemilius Lepidus. Rule under the Triumvirate was only in effect for about 10 years, and the government of the Republic was divided amongst the three individuals, and Mark Antony was assigned to the area of Egypt. The relationship between Mark Antony and the other members of the Triumvirate was further strained when it appeared that Cleopatra and Mark Antony were more than just governmental allies. You see, Mark Antony was married to Octavian's sister Octavia, and Mark Antony was carrying on a love affair with Cleopatra simultaneously as that marriage. As a matter of fact, they would have 3 children together.
I get older, they stay the same age.
Yes, they do.
Yes, they do.
First, they would have a set of twins, Alexander and Cleopatra. The baby of the family was Ptolemy Philadelphus. Octavian Caesar saw this relationship between Cleopatra and Mark Antony as being treason against Rome. Because the Romans really grew to despise Cleopatra, a lot of the legends about her were developed in Rome and not so positive, and also not so real. Her overt beauty and sexuality was largely fictionalized. For example, there was a story where Cleopatra had bet Mark Antony that she could consume, in today's money, $16.7 million worth of food in one meal. And so she had a very modest meal, but then at the end, she took one of her earrings with a very large pearl in it, had it placed in a cup of vinegar that dissolved the pearl into the liquid, and she drank the $16 million drink, which is complete baloney.
Laughable, man!
And it was a way for the Romans to show that she was very out of touch with reality and to cast her in a very negative light. Meanwhile, Lepidus is given the boot from the Association of the Triumvirate, which leaves only 2 members of the Triumvirate left, Mark Antony and Octavian. Almost immediately, this caused a conflict. Octavian would accuse Mark Antony of everything from having low morals to being involved with someone outside of his own ethnicity. Mark Antony would go a step further. He would explain that Caesarion was actually the legitimate son of Caesar and thus the heir to all of Rome. And once Mark Antony was divorced from Octavia, he would sling them both through the mud by claiming that their adoption to Caesar was completely forged and irrelevant.
What'd you do?
For that claim, Octavian would charge Mark Antony with treason, as well as hold him personally responsible for Pompey's execution without trial by the Egyptians, and war was swiftly declared against Cleopatra and the Egyptians. This came to a peak with the Battle of Actium on September the 2nd, 31 BCE. Basically, the Roman navy would overpower Antony and Cleopatra, and they were forced to escape to Egypt. Fearing death from being captured, Mark Antony would commit suicide on the beach, and Cleopatra would soon follow. Mark Antony would literally fall on his sword to die. So the story goes, he was with Cleopatra in his final moments.
Dead giveaway. Dead giveaway.
Cleopatra also took her own life, fearing captivity from Octavian. The popular myth is that she was bitten by a poisonous asp. Now this is a little bit redundant because an asp is a poisonous snake of any sort. And Egypt is most known for 2 unique venomous snakes. One is the viper. The viper's venom is very potent and really would have messed somebody up if they would have used it or been bitten by that snake. Most say this is a horrible way to die. The other snake was the cobra. The Egyptian cobra could produce enough venom in one strike to kill 2 dozen elephants. And it's relatively fast acting, so it is most likely that Cleopatra would have used this venom for her own suicide. As we know from history, Octavian would go on to change his name to Augustus Caesar and name himself the Emperor of Rome. To me, it's interesting that the Republic of Rome would fall because of fear. They feared a female in power. They feared the Egyptian son of Julius Caesar. And they feared being governed by Mark Antony along with Cleopatra, and that fear inevitably would destroy their republic.
Spare me.
So what was to become of Cleopatra's children? The biggest threat to Octavian was certainly Caesarion, whom he had murdered. Mark Antony's children got a lot better treatment. All 3 were sent to Octavia, the ex-wife of Mark Antony.
Okay! Ah, pity the poor fool! Don't eat my cereal!
I don't know why I've been watching a lot of Pee Wee Herman lately, but I've been watching a lot of Pee Wee Herman lately. having like a Pee Wee Herman crisis. I'm having like an 80s reboot in my brain.
The death of Cleopatra marks the end of rule in Egypt by the pharaoh, and it begins the time that Egypt is a part of the Roman Empire. As a ruler, Cleopatra really did a good job.
I always try to work in a color for a living.
In Cleopatra's time as ruler, there was 22 years of prosperity and stability in the country, an improved economy. She would make sure that people were fed during drought and offer tax amnesty to those in need, which made for a very stable time in Egypt as a whole. If you'd like to get more in-depth information on Egypt, check out my video on the subject.
Herman has nothing to do with Cleopatra. Nothing.
Man, I love the story of Cleopatra.
Hey, thanks for... Hey. Hello. I'm here.